A very good afternoon all. I am Dr. Kajal Yadav from medical team of Cadila, and I welcome you all for today's live webinar titled Nutrient Atmanirbharta, Know What You Eat. It is a very undeniable and very known fact that what you eat and what you choose not to eat is very detrimental in warding off chronic illnesses and diseases. And also it is a very integral part of a good lifestyle. Especially in building a robust immunity, which is even more important in today's times of the pandemic. So to enlighten us more on this topic, today we have invited Ms. Ruby Sound, who is a celebrity nutritionist and a consultant dietitian. Thank you, ma'am, for joining us. She is proprietor Eatwise Nutrition and Wellness Clinics, and she is secretary Indian Dietetic Association Mumbai Chapter. And also assistant editor, Indian Journal of Medical Sciences. Ma'am, we are very thankful to you joining us today and helping us out on this very important and relevant topic. So over to you, ma'am, on this note. Over to you, ma'am.
A very good afternoon and a COVID-free namaskar to one and all who are attending this session. Firstly, I must thank each one of you who are working either on the field or, you know, who are connecting with doctors, meeting them, and, you know, helping millions and millions of patients indirectly. But it's very important that, you know, you as a part of this team of healthcare professionals, at the backdrop, you are also very, very important in terms of your own health. So if you are healthy, you are, having a good immune system, you are fit enough. So you actually then are able to take care of others. I've got a message to make full screen. Well, I will be actually directly taking you to the presentation slides. But before that, I want to thank the entire organizing team of Cadila, the Blue Tree, and the DigiMed who have made this possible. And today, unfortunately, we can't meet in a conference hall. We can't meet in your office, so we are connected digitally, and that's the good thing, because we can meet everybody today on our common platform. It's important to understand what is important for our own health, so that is why we have a presentation which talks about nutrient atmanirbharta. Atmanirbharta is a very popular terminology now, and let's see how your colleagues want you all to be more atmanirbhar. So moving forward, let me share the screen here. Is the screen visible to everybody? All right, thank you. So to begin with, how does one make oneself nirbhar in terms of nutrients? Let's go to basics, you know, what we've been taught in schools, you know, to take carbohydrates, protein, fat, but over the period of time, especially with our, you know, working life, we forget the basics and we move on, and we really, you know, go back and look at it when we either fall ill or when there is a, you know, a disease prevalent in the family and we are at a high risk. But if we can look at it at a very, very nascent stage, I think we'll be able to do much better and avoid all such diseases. Okay. Now, the agenda of today's talk is to understand why it's important to know how to be atmanirbhar in terms of nutrients. Because of the current situation also, we are in very unprecedented times where our own health is completely dependent on what kind of immune system we have. And we know that food plays an important role. As I said, you know, we are what we eat. So it's important that our gut, our body is able to deal with all these situations outside. We need to prevent any kind of diseases, whether they're communicable diseases or non-communicable diseases. And we see that all of them at a, you know, at a very rampant speed. We know even if you already have some kind of a, you know, non-communicable disease like diabetes, like hypertension, or cardiac diseases, we can still help ourselves, you know, by understanding what to eat. And who, because today we know, okay, if your immune system is good, if you're healthy, if you're fit, you're going to survive. Whether in survival in terms of your, you know, work life or your personal life. Survival of the fittest is the key word now. We have to work on ourselves. There's no second opinion about it. Now, most important question, it's a million-dollar question to be honest. How do we become Atmanirbhar? And that answer we get from the following presentation where we talk about what is a balanced diet, okay? What is the importance of micronutrient? And supplementation today is very well accepted because everything that you get in terms of food is not organically produced. The agriculture is using a lot of pesticides, fungicides and other fertilizers which may not give the adequate amount of nutrients. We know that regular exercise and sleep are also very, very important besides the nutrition. So put together by the end of presentation, we will have some take-home points which will help us better. Moving further, now my question to all of you attending this is, do you have these, any of these or all of these complaints? If you have even one of these, I think you are attending the right session. Do you fall ill every second day? Do you sneeze in the morning? Do you have cough more frequently? Do you fall ill if you eat something, from outside? If you have a bad gut, then you need to rethink of what you're eating. Do you feel tired? Do you feel weak? Are you really drenched out at the end of the day? Whether you're in field or whether you're at home, not because of the change in the climate now, but do you really get too fatigued with your family and your work? Do you complain of this because your long hours are sitting now, you are continuously using either a mobile phone or you're using a laptop or you're carrying those heavy laptop bags? Do you complain of backaches? Do you have joint pains? Do you also see that over a period of time, your vision has become poor? Do you have a weak eyesight? You're really very tired and you just want to close your eyes for some time. Nor do you have brittle nails because, sitting in front of the computer, you don't know what you're doing. You may have brittle nails. You may have brittle hair also. Do you complain of, forgetting things more often now than before? You have done something, you've said something, you've kept something, but now you don't remember. Is that because of some micronutrient deficiency? Are you seeing baldness pattern? Not because of hereditary, but otherwise also. Is it because of a poor nutrient intake? Okay. Do you see that there is a change in the texture of your skin? Are you getting a scaly skin? Is your skin dry? Is your skin itchy? It's not because of any cosmetic product usage. It could be because of a micronutrient deficiency. Or are you at a high risk? Or are you currently having diabetes? As women, do you have insulin resistance? Are you PCOS? Do you have osteoporosis or osteomalacia? Or a non-communicable disease like cancer? Is there a high risk of cancer in your family? Or it could be anything else. So if you answer one of these questions as yes, I think it's time to rethink on what you're eating. I wish I could see some participants and see the hands of people, who would say yes to one of them. But I think everybody today, tomorrow or yesterday have experienced one of these. And it's all because of the nutrition. And to add to this agony, we've been locked in our homes for a long while now. Even those who are in the field now for some time have been, indoors. So our lives have completely changed in the last 1 year. We're all working from home. You, your family, your children at home, they're all using their laptops or their mobile phones to do their work. And we're all becoming physically inactive. Even if you were going, for a walk after your work or you were, in a gym earlier, now you've become physically inactive. And we all agree that our lifestyles have become more and more sedentary. And today, with the second wave, again, even if we had started going to the gyms, even if we had started going to the parks and all, again, we've taken a U-turn, we're back on our chairs now. And unfortunately or sadly, because of all this, our exposure to sunlight drops day by day. That's very sad, but that's a fact. And when we are at home, there's no sunlight. We know that, some nutrients are very, very important, which can also increase depression, anxiety, and all this adds to what we eat. At home, either your wife or your, or anybody at home who is cooking for you, she may be working. She has got home office work. So cooking home and getting home food is not possible every time, right? Also, just put a request on Zomato and Swiggy. The food is in front of you. And especially with these exciting offers, get 20% extra, rupees 100 on your first offer. With this app, you download the other app, you share it with your friends, and you good discounts. Do we really have a mindful eating pattern anymore? I don't think so. And the kind of food which is available to us, whether it is through these apps or it is, you know, on the shelves of the stores now or in these mall, you know, who have all the processed foods, we are getting exposed to more and more amount of processed and packaged foods. Okay, we're not picking up fresh fruits and vegetables. No more we are going to the bhaji wala. Either we ask some bazaars, star bazaars and food malls to deliver it to our houses, or we get the cut vegetables, or we are getting the pre-cooked meals for ourselves. So the intake of fruits and vegetables has far thus reduced in our lives. And we end up eating more caloric dense foods and less nutrient dense foods. I'll come to this slide once again to make it very clear. What is the difference in these two terminologies? Where are we going wrong? Because ultimately what we are eating is a very low protein diet, which are very high in fat also, and which are very high in carbohydrates. And that's the background of our all ill health and poor immune system. And as I said, when we are stressed, we add to this by either eating chocolates. Okay. Now we are, you know, eating and no more. We are eating only seafood. We are seeing food and we are also eating food. Okay. And even if we are non-vegetarians in a country like us, our intake of non-vegetarian or protein foods is very limited. You know, we decide, aaj shanivar hai, we can't eat non-vegetarian food. Ya aaj koi bhagwan ka din hai, we can't eat. Even if we eat, it's only one meal a day, or maybe a smaller portion. So the percentage of non-vegetarians any which way is low in our country. And beyond that, their consumption is very, very infrequent. And this is the challenge that we cannot do much about it, that even if we look thin, you know, our body fat percentage is more high compared to the Caucasian population. We eat anything which is packaged and processed, and, you know, we just ordering food and sitting, which is a new disease now, is adding to the whole problem. We are doing everything from our chair. So we know that if we want to reverse all this, we need to eat a better diet. So whether you're eating home food or you're ordering outside food, our thalis typically look, which are nutrient in, no, not rich. And even if they're nutrient rich, which nutrient is very prominent in our plate? These are the macronutrients. For me to make it very clear that macronutrients and micronutrients are two different types of nutrients that we all consume. So if you look at a thali, a layman would say that dal, chapati, bhaji, roti, all these things. But from my perspective, this is a plate loaded with carbohydrates and fat. Whether it is a Gujarati food or a Punjabi food or a Maharashtrian thali, we're eating more of rice and we are eating more of the bhat in our plates. And the bhajis or dals come in little katoris to us. So for me, a typical Indian plate should ideally have more than 50 to 60%, which is called as a balanced meal. The fat should come contribute to only 20 to 30% of energy, and protein should have been at least giving 10 to 15% of total energy. But look at what we are eating throughout the day. We ideally should be eating all the five food groups. As I explained earlier, the macronutrients and the micronutrients are two different types of nutrients. Macronutrients are those which give you energy, which give you calorie, which are carbohydrates, proteins, and fats. And what is very vital is the intake of micronutrients, which are either vitamins or minerals. But we don't tend to eat all the food groups which are placed here, whether they are cereals, vegetables, fruits, milk and milk, dairy, or non-vegetarian foods. We eat something like this. We eat only macronutrient-rich foods throughout the day. Morning typically would start office jana hai, pick up your bags, have a cup of chai, roll and rusk. Or if you want to sit online, you will still, have quickly this and maybe a plate of carbs. Lunch, the smallest dippy will be your salad. Major portion will be your rice or chapati folded in that foil, or, you know, dals and vegetables in the small katoris. Evening, if you're outside, yes, all these stalls are now open. You want to lay your hands on vada pav or any cheat meal in the evening. And dinner with the family will have a proper thali. Again, one small katori of non-veg food or vegetable salad may or may not be there. And family sab baad mein baitho, let's cut a whole fruit and divide it. So are we looking at what we're eating? Are we eating the required micronutrients as per the recommended dietary allowances? Well, we are very far away from that. We're eating carbohydrates coming from whether these are chapatis or breads or, you know, modern day pastas and cereals. We get you know, we have fruits and now mango is in season. So ek katori amras, maybe you'll have two or three mangoes and a little extra sugar added to it. Or if you're on the go, let's buy some fruit juice from outside. Let's just buy, pick up and eat some bananas. Whether it is complex sugar or it is simple sugar, our intake is far, far more. And with this increasing summer heat, a lot of times you just buy these, you know, soft drinks and, you know, chilled water and you pick, you know, just grab them. Do we eat really enough amount of proteins? Now, we know that proteins can be either plant-based proteins or animal-based protein. Though animal-based proteins are class 1 protein because they have complete branching amino acids also. They have essential and non-essential amino acids as well. In fact, even if we know that egg, chicken, lean meat, fish are a class 1 protein, our intake is limited to less. Even the dairy products are ideal for one because, you know, you get all the micronutrients like calcium and vitamin D is also present in some amount. But you also tend to forget that what kind of a paneer or milk are you taking? Are you taking a low fat product or a high fat product? Are you taking cheese or butter if you talk of milk? Whereas on the other hand, when we know when the plant sources which we commonly often consume as Indians are dals and pulses, okay? They're not only rich in proteins, but they're also rich in fiber. They're also loaded with a lot of micronutrients like magnesium. Some pulses like rajma, chana are all also rich in calcium and not to forget iron. These micronutrients which are available are not looked at. We only look at pulses like, okay, this is a source of protein. Let's have for the to fulfill the protein requirement. But let's see what are the other benefits that we get after consuming dals and pulses. Soya, of course, is a very good choice for those who are vegetarians. Let's not forget that even the oil seeds, even the dry fruits and nuts, good amount of protein we get. So for non-vegetarians and vegetarians, you can definitely take one fistful of these when you look at choices of protein. Good fats are very, very important for everybody's health. Well, we know that fats could be either, MUFAs, PUFAs, okay? And those which we need to skip are the saturated fats or the trans fats. All these packets that we eat, when you, you know, on the field, you just open a packet of biscuits. You're looking at carbs, but also see what kind of fat it is. You're not only eating carbs, you're also adding calories coming from the fats. So ideally, we would, you know, recommend and suggest all the people on the field or those who are sitting with their laptops to keep a fistful. So as per the recommendation, about 20 to 30 grams, which covers in this fist of mine, would include about 8 to 10 almonds, 5 to 6 of these walnut halves. Or you can also pick up some almonds like cashews and a big fistful of, you know, peanuts and chana can be kept at your desk. Make it a point to have the unsalted and the unfried ones. So even if you're, you know, attending this webinar or in the tea time and you're going to have a cup of green tea or a regular tea, make sure you munch on these. You don't munch on, you know, these chivdas and farsans and wafers altogether. You can always offer these healthy options. In terms of omega-3, yes, we know that is very, very important. So for vegetarians, we have best options as walnuts and flax seeds. So all these people who, who think if we are vegetarians and we cannot consume fish oils, we can consume omega-3 in these two formats. Very important for all of you to understand is, which is the best oil? Best oil means less oil. It could be any oil. But particularly, the fatty acid composition of each oil varies. So it's important to us for us to select the right oil. I would suggest that, you know, the most reasonable oil and the most good fatty acid profile that we Indians can take could be either groundnut oil. Okay. Of course, every culture has a different cooking method and people try making dishes in different oils. Some use mustard oil, some use sesame oil. But make sure that you predominantly use either groundnut oil or you'll cook in the rice bran oil. Alternatively, you can also use olive oil where it comes to salads and not very highly fried or very heavily cooked vegetarian or non-vegetarian dishes. Don't use oils for frying. Rather, try using different methods of cooking. It could be baking, roasting, steaming, or using an air fryer. So less oil is the best oil, I would say. So to make it very simple, what is the allowance of oil per person per day? or per month. So if you're a family of three or four, you can calculate how much oil to be bought and to be used. On an average, half a kg of oil and liter put together is allowed for one person the entire month. So the end of the month, if you're a family of four, 2 kg should suffice all visible fats that you're using for cooking methods and using butter as a topper. So make sure you keep all this in mind. That also includes ghee for that matter. So keeping these things in mind will ensure that you do not end up eating calorie dense foods. Now, this is what is the difference in a nutrient dense food and calorie dense food. And this makes you nutrient atmanirbhar. If you eat the foods on my right hand side within the red category, may give you a lot of energy. Itni dhoop mein you're sitting, you just see a McDonald's site, either you can pick up on your way or you can sit there and you feel so nice with that chilled ice pack Coke. And with that, you're eating garam garam fries and that yummy mayonnaise dripping out of your bun and burger. Well, you're actually eating what you should have done for the entire day. Your entire day's allowance of less than 2000 calories is all done here itself. And especially if they ask you at the counter, small, medium or large, 20 rupees difference. Okay, let's call for a large. Or two of you sitting, let's call for a huge meal, a combo meal, not a smaller meal. Are you going to get enough vitamins, minerals? Are you getting enough proteins? Are you getting enough nutrients? So if you want to be Atmanirbhar, you need to make the right decision. How much to eat and what to eat. Vis-a-vis, if you look at the left-hand side, which says about 1950, this is just for depiction. These are not the actual calories and not the actual calculation. This is to make everybody understand that look at the amount of food that you can eat if your allowance is not more than 2000 calories. It can be so many servings of vegetables, so many servings of salads. You can carry salads with yourself. It's not so difficult to carry carrots and cucumbers and tomatoes or order. It's not difficult to eat at least one or two eggs a day. Okay, it's not very difficult to include some fruits in your day, whether you carry an apple, an orange. Nowadays, you see strawberries. A lot of strawberries are getting sold now. You can pick up that. So much of food you can eat. So this means these are all less in calories, but dense in nutrients. And that gives you everything that you need. Vis-a-vis on the right, you're only getting calories. So make sure that if you want to be Atmanirbhar in terms of nutrient, you choose low calorie but highly nutrient dense meals, which could be more of vegetables, fruits, high fiber, high protein, and not high fat. So say no to high fat. All these pictures, I'm sure all of you have eaten and you eat regularly, but henceforth, if you want to keep up your immunity, you want to keep your weight under check, if you want to stay lean, and if you also want to, you know, have a better in terms of your memory, better in terms of your attention span and better in terms of your focus, I think you must choose foods vis-a-vis these fatty foods, which are going to only give you more of micronutrients and less of macronutrients. And it's very important to understand, especially those micronutrients which help you in building up your immunity. We are all in tough times. You never know whom you're meeting. Is the person COVID positive? Is the person a carrier of COVID positive, or is a patient himself? Are you meeting a doctor who's seeing such patients? Are you really getting exposed to this today? This happened with me this morning only. I was seeing patients till 12 in the afternoon. And once I got back home, I got a call from the other doctor who was seeing this patient to tell me that this patient has one member of the family COVID positive and the report has come last evening only. And I've already seen the patient, the other colleague has seen. So you never know whom you're coming across. It's important to, you know, enrich your bodies with these vitamins. The vitamins which either are water soluble or fat soluble are equally important. We know the water soluble vitamins are those which will, you know, leave the body as they're soluble in water. They're vitamin B, a series of B12s, B1, B6, B9, all these vitamin B and the C complexes. On the other hand, we know that vitamins which are fat soluble are also important. And these are all your vitamin A, D, E, K, and lots of minerals. There are some trace elements and some minerals which are important for immunity building also, whether it is zinc and iron. And now I think everybody's literate about these vitamins. Sabko bayat ho gaya, which vitamin tablet to take for what. But it's important to understand the basic of each. And we must stick to the recommendations given by the ICMR. This is a very recent publication. This report was published in the previous year, where they have actually come with the estimated average requirements other than the recommended dietary allowance. And that very clearly shows there has been slight difference in these values. I'm not going to read out this chart. Everybody can download this. It's a very useful document for everybody based on what supplement or food you're taking. And there are many food apps where you can put what you've eaten, and that gives you the actual calculation of what is your current intake. So this table tells us about all besides macronutrients, the requirement of a micronutrients, and specifically for the trace element, which we never think of. We are only talking of some important macronutrients. It's important to consume as per the RDA recommended by the ICMR. So if we have to eat that much, what would it look like in terms of food? Okay. So if I want to have that many grams of or milligrams or micrograms of vitamins and minerals, I'll have to end up my day by consuming about 3 cups, which is almost 300 ml or grams of any milk based products. Okay. I may have to eat all the cereals which come from rice or, you know, bajra or jawari or any millets. I'll have to eat 7 to 8 servings. Pulses, I'll have to end up by eating 3 katoris. Now, is it really practically possible? For some, it may be. For some, it may not be. Because sometimes dal is, you know, you cannot carry in the tiffin. So, sirf raat ko, once a day, you can have it. People generally, or there are some communities which cook very thin dal. So, the amount of protein is less and more of water. Nuts, of course, sometimes people, you know, have a myth that, you know, nuts are high in fats. Are they good to consume? 5 teaspoons of vegetable cooking oil is allowed. 1 fruit minimum. All 3 to 4 cuttings of vegetables. Sadly, in our country, toh bhaji banti hai, toh it's overcooked. Or the amount of vegetable that we consume is very, very less. And if to add to that, if you can eat another katori of green vegetables, if you take this kind of a diet, which is less than 2000 calories, you should be able to meet all your vitamins and minerals as recommended. However, even if we consume all this, many a times it is not possible on a daily basis. It may happen on some days, it may not happen on some days. And for some people and for some phases of life, the requirement may be much, much high. Whether you're a young adult or you're a young woman who has the reproductive age, the requirement for calcium, iron, vitamin D, zinc may be a little higher than other phases of life. So you must not look at, as the 4, components of the plate, you put only protein, vegetable, fruit, and that ho gaya. That is not sufficient for all of us. But make sure that your plate is not like 50% of carb. It comes only at least 25%, and there are other food groups. So food diversity is extremely important for all of us. I think I have to discuss about immunity to all of you, because all of you all of us are at high risk as of today. So the role of micronutrients is very, very important in terms of immunity for all of us in today's times. And we know that our immune system is any which way active in our bodies all the time. But when there is an invasion of a pathogen, okay, whether it's a viral load or a bacterial load, our immune system gets activated. And with that activation of immune system, our metabolic rate increases. So metabolism increases, and which increases our demand of energy, whether in terms of glucose or in terms of amino acids or in terms of fatty acids. We need all of this in excess as compared to a non-infected phase of a life. And we know all this comes from where? Either through the diet or through a dietary supplement. Okay? Because we know that when there is good nutrition, it will create an environment in which the immune system will flourish. And that can also reduce the susceptibility to further infection. And even if you've got the viral infection somehow, okay, if your immune system, if you're all cytokines, if you're all interleukins, everything is in place, you will be able to fight the disease or avoid invasion or reduce the viral load. You will be able to recover in case if you have got the infection. So in nutrition indirectly plays a very, very important role. So it's not the dal chawal that we look at. We look at the role of vitamins like vitamin A, D, E, K, vitamin C, B12, zinc, selen. These, some of the micronutrients are very bad. That's why you see that, when you are having slightest of symptom or fear that, you've started getting a sore throat, some slight change in the temperature, or, you are a little worried because you met somebody, you got exposed to the infected environment, you will quickly start taking your vitamin C supplementation. You'll start zinc supplementation. You take B12 supplementation. So how does it help? So let me go through one by one. I will go through not only in terms of immunity, but otherwise also which micronutrients are going to play a role. I put all the fruits and vegetables that are listed up in that image form, which tells you that vitamin A comes from these sources, which are all red, orange, and milk products, and nuts and dry fruits also. And we know that vitamin is extremely, extremely important for our eye health. Today, when we are highly exposed to the blue light, we need a good eye health. And for that, we will have to make sure that we consume foods or supplements which also have some amount of vitamin A. And this is a fat-soluble vitamin, if you remember. And very, very important in the immune system, as I mentioned to you earlier. And of course, if you are also worried about the respiratory tract infection, make sure you're taking vitamin A also. And especially in children, you will see that, you know, it takes care of all the respiratory infections. So make sure you feed yourself and your children with pulses, with egg yolks, and with all orange, red, and dark green color vegetables, which will give you adequate amount of vitamin A. Vitamin B12 and other vitamins are all water soluble. And we know that they usually, see, basically vitamin B is not in the active form in the food that we consume. B12 especially is metabolized by the gut flora that we have, okay? And what vitamin B does is, especially the B5 and B12, is convert whatever food we have eaten into energy. Suppose you've eaten, but you have vitamin B12 is very, very low. I'm sure most of us have done that. If you're very, very low, so even if you've eaten, you're not getting adequate energy out of it. So make sure that your B12 stores are good. We know that B12 is necessary for blood formation, okay? It also is very, very important for a nervous system. And if you think, you know, brain function also, if you think, you know, I've started, you know, my memory is, you know, reducing, you know, there's somebody in my family who has dementia. Make sure you check the vitamin B12 levels. And where do you get the vitamin B12? Of course, all the non-veg foods, whether fish, lean meat, you also get from milk and milk products, green leaf vegetables, a lot of pulses. But remember, vitamin Bs are synthesized in the body. So a healthy gut, where good flora is existing, will help in the flourishing or producing more of vitamin B. Vitamin C, we've all, you know, by ourselves learned, and you know, we've experienced that if you have some sardi or some slightest of respiratory issue, either you start taking one santra or avla in your diet, or squeeze some lemon in your diet, and you know, and then you see that, okay, there may be a little, drink a glass of nimbu pani, that will really help you. And today we know the requirement may be as high as 1000 milligrams, so you may think of taking 1000 milligrams of vitamin C for yourself. And not only that, we know that it is also very important for collagen synthesis. And today when we want to build a strong immunity, we have to take foods which are a little citrus in nature. So as I said, all sweet lime, lemons, even the strawberries rich source of vitamin C. And all green leafy vegetables can give you, all the bell peppers, which are different colors. And now our favorite mangoes, which are also rich in vitamin A, equally rich in vitamin C. One of the cheapest Indian foods which are rich in vitamin C is our favorite parrot food, which is the peru, amrud that we call it as, guava. And besides that, amla, the Indian gooseberry, is the richest source of vitamin C. Another thing we must importantly remember is vitamin C is not only itself very important to our body, it also helps in absorbing the iron. So suppose if you're taking a green leaf vegetable or any other source which is rich in iron, if you squeeze a lime on it, it helps in the absorption of absorption of iron in the body. Ascorbic acid helps in the iron of absorption of iron. So make sure every time you carry a dabba tiffin, you keep one fourth piece or half a piece of lemon with it. Remember, it is very sensitive to heat and very sensitive to light. So if you make a nimbu pani and carry with you, it will turn bitter and it will not taste good. Either any fruit juice. Because it's sensitive, it will get denatured. So use and squeeze freshly. And also remember, ki while cooking, if you are having a plate of poha, which is either rich in iron or green leaf, don't add the lemon and cook it for a longer period of time, because that will denature the vitamin. You need to, once you bring it down from the gas, once it will cool down, then you squeeze the lemon to ensure the vitamin C remains intact. So if you keep these few points in mind, you will get adequate amount of vitamin C besides taking vitamin C supplementation. Here comes the sunshine vitamin D. In today's time, this, you know, it's quite hot, there's enough of sun. Even if we expose ourselves for some time, we know that it is not the active form. The sunshine vitamin, actually, it gets synthesized under the skin. So, you know, we absorb one kind of, vitamin D formula, which gets biosynthesized in the body and gets converted into a synthesized form. So the cholecalciferol, which goes into the body, goes through the enzymatic reactions in the liver and the kidneys and gets converted to calcitrol. So we know that it's a body's mechanism which should be strong enough, because there's not any great food or any food which will actually give us ready-made vitamin D, which is biologically active. Though it may be present in, you know, red meat, it may be present in the yellow of the yolk, or it may be present in the oily fish, or you may also buy foods which are fortified with vitamin D. But what is very important is to ensure that your system is ready to convert that inactive form to the active form. Or you directly consume supplements or formulas which are active by itself. And it's very important to consume this, because globally we've seen a rise in the vitamin D deficiency. So nowadays, what I see in my practice also, every patient who comes to an endocrinologist or even to a gynecologist, or of course to a ortho or to us also, we ensure that among all the other tests that we recommend, we also want to do and see whether the patient is deficient in vitamin D. And sadly, we see yes, whatever may be the symptom of a patient, there may be some vitamin D deficiency in such patients. So we know that yes, if we want strong bones, we want children to grow, we want older adults not to have fractures, we want strong bones, vitamin D is important. The very fact that vitamin D helps in absorption of calcium makes us ensure that we have adequate amount of vitamin D in our body. And we see in a lot of older adults, because their bones are soft, because maybe they're not having adequate amount of vitamin D either in one of these food sources, or they're not taking any dietary supplement, their bones are very soft, osteomalatic they are, they quickly get into fractures, and that makes it difficult. Surprisingly, vitamin D, this is a very recent work that people are doing, is to identify its role in the parathyroid gland functioning. What we understood that if the calcium intake is less, or if vitamin D is less in the body, the parathyroid glands will borrow the calcium from your bones, okay, just to make sure that the calcium levels are good in your blood. And that is why your bones are become more and more porous, more and more weaker. Vitamin D not only plays a direct role, but an indirect role with the gland secretions also. And today you will see there are n number of publications, lot of class one evidence now, lot of data being presented, lot of meta-analysis being done. Yes, there is a link between diabetes and vitamin D deficiency. Besides heart disease and besides these bone diseases, diabetes is having a correlation. Even the patients who come with hypothyroidism have been shown to have a low levels of vitamin D. Surprisingly, we've also seen there is adequate link in vitamin D deficiency and mood and depression and anxiety levels. So if you see your patient is, the person who we're connected with is having some mood disorders, you can quickly cross-check with the vitamin D levels besides other things. And today, vitamin D also plays a very, very important role. So far, vitamin D has not been studied for immunity until this COVID pandemic, until this COVID virus has made us realize that yes, vitamin D deficiency is very, very crucial in the patients with comorbid conditions who suffer from COVID-19. So the prevalence of deficiency of vitamin D is so prevalent that, it cannot go unnoticed henceforth. Moving further to the other vitamin, which is vitamin E, we have always been knowing this vitamin E as antioxidant, which delays aging, protects the cell damage. And today we know that, it also assists the immune system. So where do we get this vitamin? Is from, since it's a fat soluble, you'll see all the dry fruits and nuts and the oil seeds are rich in vitamin E. When you talk of skin health, when you talk of hair health, consuming some amount of dry fruits every day, or some amount of sunflower seeds, sesame seeds, they help you not only because they are rich in vitamin E, they're also rich in calcium. So focus on this vitamin E for all those who are outdoors under the sun and the skin being exposed, because antioxidants are very, very important. Similar to that, now moving on to the minerals. Today, very important is to have a good, zinc levels in our body. It definitely promotes the immune functions. We know the antibody production is, is dependent on the amount of zinc level that we have in our body. So far, we've been knowing that, okay, zinc is very, very important in the reproductive age group and for healthy pregnancies. But today, it's quite well established that zinc is equally important to prevent or to take care of all the upper respiratory tract infections like pneumonia. And if, even for small children, if you give zinc supplementation to children, even the diarrhea can be taken care of. Where do we get zinc from? Zinc is available in loads and lots of foods, whether it is the pulses, whether it is cereals, whether it is the egg yolk. All these seeds also have some amount of zinc present. Even if you're not able to meet the zinc requirement, you know, you get many options available now over the counter, or you can ask the doctor to ensure that your zinc levels are optimum for your optimum health. One of the other trace elements which are becoming very, you know, which are quite talked about is selenium. Selenium, there are some studies which have shown some impact of selenium levels on our thyroid function also. Besides being a very, very popular antioxidant, we know that it's also crucial for reproductive health. So for all those who are of a middle age group, make sure that you are taking selenium from all the meat, all the cereals and all the pulses. Ensure that all fruit groups are there because that gives you different kind of macro and micronutrients. Iron, I will not discuss too much in length about this because iron itself, this topic is quite vast. But in short, we know that iron deficiency causes anemia. It's very important for the motor and cognitive development in children. And today, we're talking about infections. And again, iron plays a very important role. And all the green leaf vegetables, remember that spinach is the papaya food is not the highest source of iron at all. Methi, shepu, mustard leaves, amaranth leaves, other drumstick leaves are all rich in iron, but not only spinach. The red meat is rich in iron. All the whole pulses that you eat as vegetarians also are rich in iron. The yellow, many of people throw the egg yolk because it seems to be high in cholesterol and they don't take the yolk. But remember, that is a very rich source of iron which you're discarding. So remember not to discard the yolk of the egg. So iron is very important. So after understanding all the vitamins and minerals and the macronutrients, we understand that the reality is today our requirements are more than ever before. Whether you are getting exposed to the patients, whether you are working long, long hours, whether there's a lot of mental stress, 31st March this year, you still have your accounts to be closed. You still don't get adequate sleep. If you have some family member who's under quarantine, who's got positive, that adds to your burden. So the ground reality is our demands are more. So only food is not going to suffice you, right? Even if you have all the food groups and everything, you may require that little extra to meet your RDS or ERAs along with some dietary supplement, either in the form of a powder, either in form of a capsule, either in form of a tablet, or in form of a fortified food. You definitely need an extra dietary supplement. So this is just a small example of ideally how you can meet all the requirements. Especially for all of you who are working on the field, you can start your day not with a regular chai and coffee because that's going to, have an impact on the iron absorption. So stay away from number of chais and coffee. Don't wait at every tea shop. And there are n number of tea shops now I see. Every lane one chai stall has opened up. Earlier there were coffee shops and every lane has one chai ka dukan. And in your office, if you sit, chai ka cup. If you're sitting on a desk, yes, one coffee. These are all going to hinder the absorption fine. So might as well start your morning with a kadha kind of a preparation, which could be a herbal tea, or it could be a ready green tea wherein you can add a few things like vitamin C in the form of lemon. You can add some mint or pudina leaf. You can add a little bit of cinnamon. If you want a little bit of haldi, you can put that. Or maybe additionally, you can add ginger to it. So this is going to become a health drink loaded with nutrients. So remember, this is a good example of nutrient dense versus calorie dense. So this is nutrient dense. A calorie dense chai ka cup would be lots of milk, lots of sugar, and only chai ki patti. Vis-a-vis, this is going to be a nutrient dense and low calorie drink. Breakfast, make sure there is protein to begin your day with. Whether it is egg for non-vegetarians, or it is a moong ka chilla for vegetarians, or simply a katori of dahi for those who are eating any other breakfast, like a cereal breakfast. Make sure you are having some protein to start your day. Because these proteins and amino acids are also very, very important for building your immunity. mid-morning, too hot for you to, you know, decide what to buy, either a soft, a chilled cold drink or a buttermilk. Carry your chas or buy from anywhere. But make sure you have some seeds along with it, whether it is flax seeds loaded with sunflower seeds, loaded with zinc, loaded with other minerals. That would be a good choice for you. And of course, that is the time you may be exposed to sunlight. You may be getting a good amount of vitamin D for yourself. So here, if you take a cup of milk, you have calcium and you are under the sun, so you get vitamin D, a good combination to work for you. Your lunch tiffin, I'm sure, should be more than only one chota dabba, which has got roti and bhaji. Ensure that you carry one pulse with you. And if you have a small limbu ka tikda along with it, which you can squeeze it before you consume lunch. If you have enough space in your bag, your laptop is smaller, please carry a small tiffin, which has got some salad in it. So finish your salad and have a meal. So make sure it's not 60% or 80% of carb. It's only as much as other vegetables and pulses are. Tea time. Please, please, please don't spend money on vada paos and samosa paos. They're only calorie dense. They're not nutrient dense. They're deeply fried and they've been using the same cocoa oil, which has been reused over and again, over and again, over and again, and completely oxidized oil, which they use. It's easier to spend 10 rupees and buy that mungfali ka packet or the chana wala who sells the chana. And if you don't want to, you know, you don't want to come in contact with anybody and buy something from them, carry from your home. It's not so difficult to carry. Dry fruits and nuts and oil seeds can all be carried at this time. Or fruit can give you lots of vitamins. And besides that, if you can either, you know, buy coconut water, that will give you again some vitamins. If you may be outside at that time or at home, you can grab that or drink a glass of lemon water, even that would be sufficient. Or you can take a, you know, a protein supplement, a shake, which you can, you know, have this, because this is a cheat time. Okay, whether you're at home or whether you're at office or whether you're on the field, this can go wrong for many of the people. So be careful on tea time. Dinner, of course, our family time, more variety of food is available. Be very, very selective of what you're eating. Depends on how your day has been. If you have been, you know, sedentary all day, make sure you're taking very less amount of dinner. Be very thoughtful. You know, that's called mindful eating. And ensure that you eat not till your stomach is completely full and tight and you can't eat a morsel more. Keep yourself, you know, it's called hachi hara bu in Japanese, which is like, you know, in some community of India also, apna pet thoda khali rakhna chahiye, so that, you know, there's enough place in your stomach for one more chapati. That much less you eat. That, you know, because that's the last meal of the day and you need not eat as much as you eat for the lunch. Of course, to make sure that your immune system is at par, you want to take a haldi wala golden milk. Even the Ayush ministry has given recognition that yes, at bedtime, make sure you end your day with a cup of milk which has turmeric in it. And to make sure that the absorption of curcumin is good, you need to add a pinch of black pepper powder. That is very, very important, which is not known to many of us. So ensure you take haldi wala doodh with little pepper powder. That should be the last meal of the day. And of course, make sure you are taking all required dietary supplements, whether it is vitamin D, whether it is vitamin B12, whether it is zinc, whether it is vitamin C. Ensure that you don't miss out on your regular medicine plus dietary supplement. That makes the food complete. Supplement means additional to the food. So that makes a balanced diet. Of course, hydration is important because no matter what you eat, you need to have adequate amount of water to make sure that, you know, everything gets absorbed. So this is all about food and, you know, ways to make yourself very, very strong in terms of immunity. We all know that, yes, sleep, stress management, exercise are very, very important, but this is beyond the scope of today's discussion. We need to ensure that all these things are in place for us to ensure that whatever we have eaten has been, you know, completely utilized by our body. Because we know if our immunity is tough, we can stay tough. But as we all know, tough times never last, but tough people do last. So to make ourselves tough, we need our immune system in best of health. So with these last words, I thank everybody for being here with me on this platform. And I will stop sharing the screen now. So if there are any questions, you can take those questions. Over to you, Mr. Mehul.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am, for such a lucid and enlightening presentation of Nutrient Atmanirbharta. I think it's one of the best ever presentation I have seen in my life. Thank you. Thank you so much. Now I can proudly say I have taken a very strong step towards becoming the nutrient Atmanirbhar. My wife is a dietitian, ma'am. Next time she comes up with any advice on nutrient, I have the counter question ready with her. Okay. So ma'am, my particular learning is next time I'm going to order anything in a restaurant or something, I'm going to ask two things to myself, how much to eat and what to eat. That would be the first thing for me. I'm very happy to share with you. We have more than 400 Cadillians joined from Jammu Kashmir to Kanyakumari and from Gandhinagar to Guwahati. And you will see more than 50 questions have put on the system, which I need to categorize on the various segment. I will start with the first question, which is, which type of food should we include in our diet for building good immunity, especially in this pandemic time?
Firstly, thank you so much. And I'm very glad to see such an overwhelming response in terms of viewers and the questions. And I'm sure most of the questions have been answered in my presentation. So I will not repeat most of the questions. But in short, the question which I won't answer here is that all the food groups are important. You know, if you want to build up your immunity, have nutrient diverse foods and make sure you're not taking calorie dense food, but nutrient dense food. All nutrients will play an important, specifically foods which I mentioned, which are rich in vitamin vitamin D, vitamin C, and zinc as a mineral is very, very important. So make sure you eat a lot of green leaf vegetables. Make sure you eat a lot of protein-rich foods. Make sure you definitely have lots of oil seeds and nuts. They're very, very important for all of us, for every micronutrient requirement. So keep these three, four foods in your diet every day. Ensure you have this. It will help you in building immunity.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. The next question is from the Ranchi. And the question is for the growing children. The gentleman is asking which diet is very beneficial for the growing children.
So at this growing age, what is important is to keep their bone health, right? And bone health, we know now it's quite well established. The data clearly shows that vitamin D is very important for calcium absorption. Calcium by itself is important. And for the linear growth also, we require a lot of proteins in the diet, and make sure the junk food is out of the diet. So ensure that the child has a protein in every meal that he has, whether it is milk and milk products, whether it is non-veg foods. Ensure protein is a part of the diet. I think that will help a growing child. That and if the child is in the reproductive age group, ensure that zinc is also a part of the diet.
Ma'am, I have to count out of 50. There are more than 30 questions on the weight loss. And the common question is, what is the ideal way to weight loss? Which type of diet is helpful for the weight loss? And can one successfully achieve weight loss with only diet control?
Okay, all the questions are very relevant. And these questions are coming because they have been at home for over a year now. Okay, people are not at home. They were working. And if you don't meet a doctor, you're waiting in the doctor's clinic for hours and hours. You just can't open a tiffin and eat. But now you're at home. You are not traveling much. You are eating and ordering everything. Your portions have become more. So if you want to lose weight, go back to your old portions in a smaller way. You know? So even whatever you're eating, right? Suppose if you're used to eating 3 chapatis for lunch, okay? Cut down 1 chapati to begin with. If you're eating 2, have 1. Okay? If you're eating or you're skipping salad, so very, very important for all those who want to lose your weight is to include or increase the amount of fiber and protein in your diet. Because if you do that, you will tend to eat less amount of food, less calories, but your volume will be more. So we'll tend to eat less. So portion control and mindful eating is very important for all those who want to eat. So start with any protein. There should be a sequence of eating. Don't start with the chapati and a bhaji, which we typically do, or dal and rice. First, finish with the glass of chas or a bowl of dahi, which is protein, or if you have fish or eggs, okay? And you also have salads of fiber to finish first. Then you finish that dabba of salad. It could be one cucumber. It could be one tomato. It could be a sprouted bale, or it could be boiled food. Anything. Finish that first. Then the last food to pick up will be your chapati or your rice with the bhaji and the dal. Ensure you have that kind of that disciplined or sequential way of eating. It really helps all those who want to eat. And if you can calculate, you can either check with a qualified dietitian. Ensure that you create a calorie deficit of 500 calories per day. It will help you at least lose 2 or 3 kgs per month, which is a safe weight loss. So either you increase your physical activity or you reduce your food intake, create a deficit of 500 kilocalories. That will give you a very healthy weight loss. इट्स नॉट सो डिफिकल्ट. 500 मतलब 5 चपाती ऐसे गिन लो. तो 2 चपाती कम किया, कुछ और कम किया. स्टॉप ईटिंग ऑल फ्राइड. से नो टू फ्राइड. अगर घर पे अल्कोहल पीते तो वो भी कम कर दीजिए. एंड इफ सॉफ्ट ड्रिंक्स एंड ऑल दिस, गर्मी है तो स्टॉप ऑल दिस एंड से नो टू शुगर. इफ यू डू दैट मच, यू विल ऑल बी मच लीनर व्हेन यू गो बैक टू ऑफिस नेक्स्ट ईयर.
Yeah, that's very much needed, ma'am.
You should all fit into your suits also now, because sab log, everybody's waist lengths have gone up. So now if you want to go back to your old suits, you need to reduce your waist length. There's no, you can't escape this.
I agree, ma'am. Without wasting much of the time, the next question is from our senior vice president, Mr. Rajiv Saxena from corporate office. And he has asked, what percentage of children suffer from anemia, or is there any particular diet advice for them?
So anemia is a very serious problem in our country. So I've done a lot of work with girls from, you know, different types of society, either from the upper strata of society or from the underprivileged state of society. It is very, very rampant. One in every 5 girls may be anemic. Even young, small adolescent girls, or even the young women who are so busy in their career, most of them are anemic, and that leads to intergenerational cycle of anemia. And it's very important to increase iron-rich foods. Now, iron fortification is also very important. But before we go that, there are 2-3 things to be kept in mind. One, deworming of the children at a young age. Because even if you eat foods rich in iron, if there are worms and other parasites, iron absorption will not take place. So deworming is very important, which we miss on. Secondly, consumption of green leafy vegetables and inclusion of vitamin C along with vitamin D is very, very important. Nowadays, you get vitamin D fortified foods also. Now, vitamin D, we're talking about iron deficiency. So iron fortified foods are also very much available. So these 2-3 things you have to keep very, very, very prominent in these children who are iron deficient. Simply tell them to eat 2-3 khajur every day. That will help them. That's important. Mr. Mehul,
and the question is being asked by Ms. Anita Roy Chaudhary.
Hello? Lost your network. What is the question?
Audible?
Yeah, now I can see you.
The next question is from the city of Joy, Kolkata, ma'am. The question is, do you think about intermittent fasting is beneficial to health?
Good question. So it is very good for people who are used to eating so many times. So the logic here is, every time you eat food, there is a spike in the insulin, blood insulin levels, right? And to break that sequence, it is important to, so intermittent fasting is not what to eat, it is when to eat and how to eat. So you get a window period of 8 hours. There are different types of intermittent fasting. In those 8 hours, you're allowed to eat anything and everything. But if you do it under a guidance, you will be very selective in what you're eating. Then intermittent fasting really works, because the body in the fasting stage uses the visceral fat for the energy requirement. And the insulin spikes don't happen. That really, really helps in reducing your blood glucose levels, reducing your visceral fat, and also reverse your diabetes. It is really, the work is going on. The data is published for 6 months and not more than that. We don't know what happens if it's continued for more than 6 months so far.
Okay, very interesting. Ma'am, I'll take a last question considering the paucity of time. And the question is about TV commercial, which are always on the Atta Maggi, wheat pasta, brown bread. Do you think these are actually healthier than the counterparts?
So that tells us what is the type of the carbohydrate that is available to us, right? Now, if you're having your allowance for the day, if it's there in your kitty, say if you're allowed to have 300 grams of carbohydrates in the entire day, even if you have one of these, you can still do with it. But if you're anyway just eating more than 300, 400 grams of carbohydrates, then I think there's no point whether you select this or that. You have to be very cautious and count how many carbs, carb counting, which is called as, to choose that. But otherwise, honestly speaking, the amount, these commercial food products have a very less percentage of whole, the fiber in it. So you have to think 10 times before you choose the product. Read nutrition label to know what causes it. Is it whole wheat or is it only brown in color? Read the nutrition label for the correct identification.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. There are a lot of still questions are there. Maybe we will bounce it to you in the
and email. We can answer them by email. That's absolutely fine.
Yeah, ma'am. We have your email ID. We will share with everyone. Okay. So we have come to the end of this excellent program. And on behalf of entire Cadila Magnestar family, I, Mehul Raja, marketing head, would really like to thank each one of you collectively and individually for accepting our invitation and sparing your precious time for the live webinar on Nutrient Atmanirbharta, Know What You Eat. March is observed as a World Nutrition Month, and we cannot have a better person than Ruby Ma'am to talk on the various aspects of becoming Nutrient Atmanirbhar. Ma'am, on behalf of entire Cadila family, I take this opportunity to thank you for an excellent and one of the best deliberation on the importance of the nutrients in our life. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. I would like to, you know, before I leave this platform, I just want to say that one small change can make a big difference in your life, in your weight. And one person in the family can bring the change in the entire family. And one person in the company like you can help change health and make the entire company Atmanirbhar in terms of nutrient Atmanirbharta. Thank you so much for coming up with this topic.
I'll just take 10 seconds more because there are a lot of people who has worked, and I would like to thank each one of them, starting from Dr. Kajal for moderating the entire session, starting with such a wonderful idea and the setting up agenda. Thanks, Dr. Kajal. As all of you know, the ball started rolling 1 month back, and I'll be failing in my duties if I don't thank Apurva Saloni from our corporate communication department, Himanshu Bhai from design studio, my one of the most dependable person, Pushkar and Abhishek from the team of Magnestar, and of course the event partner Blue Tree. As we all of know, like 8 out of 10 Indians are vitamin D deficient. That can lead to a weakening of immunity, which might put us at the risk of the various infection and the other related problems. This nutrition month, join the mission and be the pivotal part of spreading awareness about vitamin D. To join this mission, visit and subscribe to our Facebook page, Vitamin D for Health. A lot of awareness initiatives are being planned. Once again, heartfelt and sincere thanks to each one of you for your valuable presence and contribution to make this event successful. Thank you so much and take care of yourself.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you once again, everybody. Pleasure to be here.